see Noosh now.
Time to go.
Yeah.
Has fallen, when fear is coming, still you're calling me. When faith is lost and my hope exhausted, you will be my strength. When my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. I've decided I'm not giving up. You won't give up on me. You won't give up on me. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking out like an echo. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking out like an echo. Echo to my soul. In my soul. Season, you keep repeating promises to me. And there's no stopping what you have started till it is complete. When my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. Echo. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking out like an echo. Echo in my soul. So echo. Your love is holding on and it won't let go. I feel it breaking out like an echo. Echo in my soul. Soul.
Happens every week. All right, church family, would you bow your heads with me as I open a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this time where we get to gather together and sing praises to you and hear from your word. God, during this time, let us cast aside any distractions, any thoughts that we've had in our head from this past week, and let's just refocus on you and your word, because your presence is our good. And we've learned that several times. And we've come to realize that several times, but often we just forget to just be silent and stay in your presence and just be enveloped by who you are, God. So during this time, let us refocus and listen to what you are calling us to do. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Well, church family, don't know about you, but the time lapse kind of messed me up. I'm still tired. I almost thought that, hey, we need to be going to Sunday school at this time, but no, we already did that. So if you came for Sunday school at this time, it means you didn't set your clocks back. So you're here for service, which is even better.
The other way.
The other way?
Forward.
Forward. You didn't set them forward. See, told you, it messed me up. But no, we are so glad you guys are joining us. We're glad that the time skip didn't really miss too many people. Glad everybody is accountable about that. I just rely on Janae to set our clocks because I don't need an alarm. She wakes me up. It's fine. No, but we are so glad that you guys joined us today. And if you're a guest with us, we are so happy to welcome you here at Emmanuel. And we'd ask that you'd fill out a guest card in the seat in front of you. You'll look in, there's a bunch of pamphlets and papers and cards and stuff. If you would fill out the one that says guest connection card, we would love to use that to get to know you. And not only that, but if you take that down to the front desk in the atrium, the welcome desk, we have a gift for you. So there's that exchange there. It's the card for a gift. It's, from what I hear, it's a decent gift. So I don't make them. Roger would probably know better. So if you want to find out, take that card down there and get a gift. If you're in need of prayer, there's also a prayer card in the seat in front of you. And we would ask that you would fill that out. That way your church family knows that, hey, this person needed prayer. And that way we can pray for you and let you know that we care here at Emmanuel. So church family, as we move forward, if you would turn to the person next to you, because I know you see them probably most of the time since they're probably your family, but let them know that you're glad to see them this morning.
Creator, you hold our hearts together. There's no one higher than you. Redeemer, defender, our great and mighty Savior. There's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive.
Gracious and forgive us. By your power we
kneel and shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King.
Ourselves and where we'll put other things in our lives, God, you should be on that throne, exalted above all else. I pray today, God, that we sing praises to you, we lift our voices to you, that you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And we would not second guess that, we would not back away from that, God, but it would be what we exalt, it would be what we sing, and it would be what our lives show to those around us. We love you and we praise you, Father. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning to you. I'm glad to see you here this morning. So I don't know if you remember, about a month ago, we voted as a church on the official candy bar of Emmanuel Baptist Church. Remember that? And Snickers is the official candy bar. But we had a late entry. I just learned about this new candy bar. Fred Yoder brought this to me. It's called an Idaho Spud. Has anybody ever heard of an Idaho Spud other than Fred? Let me tell you about it. It is a potato. I don't even know what's in here. So, Fred, I don't think you're going to get any votes on this one. It's probably just going to be you. Lorraine, would you vote for this one? Is this good? He can't even get his wife to vote for this one. So, but I will try it later, and I'll let you know what I think of it. I see Dwayne Grable here. Dwayne, will you come up here? Will you come up? He's playing his hearing aid card.
And how are you, sir?
I'm doing well. I'm good. I'm glad to see you.
Really?
Yeah, sometimes.
I tell you what, I'm glad to be here.
So Dwayne has been serving our church as a deacon since 1998, which was before I was born, I think.
No comment.
Dwayne has faithfully served our church, and he shared with our deacon body a couple months ago that it was time for him to step down, and I just wanted to let you know that we are grateful for him. Let you know that that's what's happening so that you can have a chance to let him know how you appreciate him. 1 Timothy 3 says that those who serve faithfully as deacons earn a good reward. And Dwayne, you have done that. And I just want you to know we are grateful for you and we love you.
Thank you. I love this church.
And we know that you do. This is for you.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Let me encourage you today that before you go, you see where he's sitting, you chase him down and let Dwayne know that you love him and how you appreciate him. Now, the memory for me of riding my very first roller coaster is etched in my memory permanently. If I'm ever visiting with a psychologist and they're trying to get to the root of everything that's wrong with me, it's probably going to come back to this moment, my first roller coaster ride. It was a trip to Six Flags. I think I was about 9 years old. That would have made my brother 7, and we were riding in the car together. So we were both really small. And I remember sitting in the car, and the attendant pushed the lap bar down, and there was about this much of a gap between my lap and the lap bar. But it was my first time. I didn't know this was going to be a problem for us. Now, I don't know when was the last time you were at an amusement park, but nowadays they strap you in with a full body harness and you can't move. But, of course, we were children of the 80s, so safety really wasn't one of the primary concerns for anyone. Now, as the ride started, we were excited until we headed down the first hill. And we came up off the seats and met the lap bar. And everyone around us, I'm sure there were screams of delight, but ours were screams of sheer terror. And then we look ahead and we see 4 or 5 more hills to come. And I think at one point my brother and I looked at each other like, this is the end. It's been nice knowing you, but it's all over. Because every time we went down, we did not feel secure. We wanted something to hold us in and we felt like we didn't have it. We needed a safeguard. Well, in our passage in Philippians today, the Apostle Paul is going to talk about a safeguard. Safeguard for you as believers, something to shield you, something to make you secure. So would you turn with me to Philippians chapter 3? I'm going to invite Kelly to come and read our scripture passage. Would you stand with me in honor of God's word? Follow along as Kelly reads.
All right, Philippians 3, 1 through 6. In addition, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. To write to you again about this is no trouble for me and is a safeguard for you. Watch out for the dogs. Watch out for the evil workers. Watch out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the circumcision, the ones who worship by the Spirit of God. Boast in Christ Jesus and do not put confidence in the flesh. Although I have reasons for confidence in the flesh. If anyone else thinks he has grounds for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised the 8th day, of the nation of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, regarding the law, a Pharisee, regarding zeal, persecuting the church, regarding the righteousness that is in the law, blameless. Philippians 3, 1 through 6. This is the word of the Lord.
Would you pray with me? God, our Father, thank you for the good gift of your word. I pray that you would use it to teach us what you have done for us and what you desire of us. And then you would grant us the motivation and the power to obey you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. I want you to know this morning that if God speaks to you through his word and you have questions about it or you want to have a follow-up conversation about it, there are ways to do that. If you're watching online with us right now, we have an online minister who is ready right now if you have questions or if you want to follow up with anything. If you're here in the room with us after the service, I'll be down front. Come find me. Let's have a further conversation if God is working in your heart. Now, there are 3 commands in these verses. 3 commands. The first 2 are explicitly stated. The 3rd one's implied. If you have a worship guide on the back side, there's fill in the blanks, and I'm about to give you the first ones. So the very first ones, the 3 commands. The first command is rejoice. The second one, watch out. And the 3rd one, remember who you are. Rejoice, watch out, remember who you are. So let's look at each of these. Starting with rejoice. Look at chapter 3, verse 1. It says, in addition, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. Remember how we talked last week that joy isn't its own thing? You can't find joy unless it's directed at another object. If I tell you right now to rejoice, you can't do that unless you think of something else to fuel that joy. And what is the object of joy that Paul points us to? He points us to Jesus, to the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. I don't know what comes to your mind when you hear the word Lord. For most of my life, I don't know why I thought this, but whenever I heard the word Lord, I always thought of God the Father. That was where my mind naturally went. But that's not who Paul means when he says rejoice in the Lord. If you turn back to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, verse 2, you can see this. He says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from who? The Lord Jesus Christ. When Paul says the Lord, rejoice in the Lord, he's saying rejoice in Jesus. Jesus is the source of our joy. We talked last week, your circumstances are not the source of your joy. Jesus is the source of your joy. And that's why he can command it, because our joy can never be taken from us. It can never be stolen. It can never be lost. We can always look to Jesus. We can look to what he's done for us. We can look to what he's going to do for us and find joy. And here's the thing. If you try to find joy in anything other than Jesus, if you try to find joy anywhere other than Jesus, it will fluctuate. It will be hit and miss. For instance, if you look for joy in relationships, let's say your spouse or your children, sure, there will be some happy times, some joy that you find there, but there will be other times when they disappoint you. They can even be taken from you. Your joy will fluctuate. Or what if you look to your job? What if you look to your career? You're making money as a way of joy. That joy is going to fluctuate. Sometimes it might work out and be fulfilling, but what happens if you get stuck with an unreasonable boss? What happens if you get laid off? What happens to your joy then? Some people look to hobbies or sports for joy. Now, you might find moments of enjoyment along the way there, but if you have poor health, you might not be able to do those things that you love anymore. Your joy can fluctuate. There's only one source of joy that will never disappoint, can never be taken from you, and that is Jesus. Pursuing Jesus is the only way to find lasting joy. I heard a preacher say this once. This is good. That's why I put it down on the sheet for you to fill in the blank. He said, if you try to pursue joy apart from God, you will get neither. But if you pursue God, you will get both. If you try to pursue joy apart from God, you won't get joy and you won't get God. You'll get neither. But if you pursue God, you'll get both. You'll get God and you'll get joy. Pursue Jesus. Now we'll talk more about this in chapter 4. But rejoicing, this command to rejoice in the Lord, it's not a feeling. It's an activity. To obey, and the way that you obey this activity is you have to get to know Jesus better. The only way for you to rejoice in Jesus is to get to know him better. That's why the very first step on our discipleship map is know Jesus. Know Jesus. And how are you going to get to know Jesus? Primarily two ways. You've got to talk to him, and you've got to listen to him. You need to talk to him, you need to pray, and you need to listen to what he says to you right here in the Bible. So this first command, rejoice in the Lord, rejoice in Jesus, it's easy to understand. It's doable for all of us. All of us can pursue Jesus and know him better and find joy in him. After Paul says, rejoice in the Lord, then he tells them the next command for their safety. Look at second half of verse 1. To write to you again about this is no trouble for me, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for the dogs. Watch out for the evil workers. Watch out for those who mutilate the flesh. How often do you use the words watch out? When was the last time you used them? A month ago? A week ago? If you're a parent with small kids, five times a day probably? So somebody, a few people, tell me, when are times that you would use the words watch out? Give me an example of when you would need to use those words. If your kids aren't paying attention. Okay, somebody cuts you off in traffic, watch out. What'd you say, Brevin?
Being good.
Well, you don't use the words watch out when you're good. Somebody else give me another example. If a baseball's flying at your head, that's a good time, Ty, to say watch out. Somebody else? When else would you use the words watch out? When you're what? When you're stocking shelves, yeah, in Walmart, the people behind you say, watch out. So we use these words, We use these words to warn someone of potential danger. That's what Paul is doing. He's warning these believers of potential danger. And what's the danger? It's these people he calls dogs, evil workers, and mutilators. Now, these are not three different types of people. Paul's talking about one group. He just gives them different, he calls them different names. And it's false teachers in the church. False teachers in the church. And he uses the strong language. Beware the dogs. You didn't know that was scripture on all the fences around, did you? Beware the dog. The scripture right here. He says, beware the dogs. Beware the criminals. Beware the mutilators. He calls them dogs because in those days, dogs were wild, vicious, homeless animals that roamed the streets. They were both a nuisance and a danger. He calls them criminals because they're doing evil works. He calls them mutilators for two reasons. First, because they were requiring the physical act of circumcision. And second, because they were mutilating the gospel. They were mutilating the gospel. Mutilate means to cut up, to alter radically. These people were altering the message of the gospel. And they were known as Judaizers. These false teachers were known as Judaizers. And a lot of times what would happen, Paul would start a church in a city. After he got the church going, he would leave. And then these Judaizers, these false teachers, would follow in behind and start teaching false teaching. Now, the church leaders in Jerusalem recognized the dangers of the Judaizers' teaching. In fact, all the leaders got together. You can read about this in Acts 15. They formed a council because the Judaizers were saying, if someone wants to be saved, wants to belong to God, yes, they need Jesus, but then they also need to keep all the Old Testament law. That's what the Judaizers' message was. Yes, you need Jesus to be saved, but you also need to keep all the laws. And the Council of Jerusalem declared that no, people are saved by God's grace alone, not by keeping the law. But even though the apostles and the elders made it clear, the Judaizers kept spreading this false teaching. That's who Paul's talking about. And you need to be aware that there are still Judaizers around today. Now, they don't go by that label. But there are churches that teach that you need more than Jesus to be saved. There are churches today that will teach you, yes, you need Jesus, but you also need X, Y, or Z to be saved. Let me give you some examples. There are some churches that say, not only do you need Jesus, but you also need to believe our doctrine exactly the way we believe it. And then you are accepted by God. If you will, yes, be saved, get Jesus, but you also need our doctrine, and you'll be saved. There are other churches that say you must not only believe in Jesus, but you also have to go through our confirmation. You have to take communion with our church to be saved. There are others who have a list of moral obligations a mile long and say, real Christians don't drink alcohol. Real Christians homeschool their children. Real Christians vote Republican. Real Christians don't work on Sunday. And they just have a list. They'll say, yes, you need Jesus to be saved, but you're not going to be accepted by God if you don't do all these other things on our list. Church family, if you ever hear a preacher say that your salvation, you being accepted before God, requires Jesus plus something else, you need to run away as fast as you can. Doesn't matter what kind of great children's program that they have at that church, how good the music is, how nice the pastor seems, if they tell you you need Jesus plus something else, they are the dogs, the mutilators, the evil workers that Paul is talking about. And you need to watch out for those kind of people, because Romans 3:28 tells us that we are justified, a person is justified by faith in Jesus, no works. We are justified, we are made right with God by faith in Jesus alone. So we've covered these first two commands: rejoice in the Lord, watch out. We find the third command in verse 3. Look at verse 3. For we are the circumcision, the ones who worship by the Spirit of God, boast in Christ Jesus, and do not put confidence in the flesh. Now, this is an implied command. There's not a direct one here, but the implied command of this whole verse is remember who you are. Remember who you are. Paul is saying that one of the safeguards for their lives is to remember what God has done for them. So at this point, we are actually going to pause the live stream. Cammy, are you up there? If you're on the live stream, our minister, Lisa, our online minister, has some questions for you and some interaction, and we'll be gone for probably 4 minutes, is my guess, and then we'll be right back. So go get you a drink of water or something like that, and then come and back and join us. All right, Cammy, are we off? That's what Paul says in verse 3. Remember who you are. How many of you have seen The Lion King? The real Lion King. Back in the 90s, in 94. The Lion King, it was either the first or second time I took a girl on a date. I took her to go see The Lion King. That was the only date we ever had. I don't know why. I love that movie. So, in The Lion King, Simba, the lion, he runs away from his pride. He abandons the kingdom. But years later in exile, he has a vision of his dad. And his dad says this to him. His dad says, remember who you are. Except, of course, it's James Earl Jones, so it's like really deep and powerful, like, remember who you are. I can't do it that good. But. Simba can't go do what he's supposed to do until he remembers who he is. That is same for all of us as Christians. We can't do what God has called us to do if we don't remember who we are in Christ. That's why the first part of verse 3 says, for we are the circumcision. This is just another way of saying we belong to God. We belong to God because that's what the act of circumcision represented in the Old Testament. That those people belonged to God. And it's ironic that Paul calls this church, the Philippian church, the circumcision, because they were all uncircumcised Gentiles. But it's because Paul's not talking about a physical act. He's talking about a spiritual reality. Colossians 2 tells us that as God's people, we don't need that physical sign anymore that we belong to God because we have a better spiritual sign. God has given us the Holy Spirit. That's the sign that we belong to God. That's the way we know. That's why he says in the second half of verse 3, we are the ones who worship by the Spirit of God. We have the Holy Spirit's presence in our lives. Do you see that evidence in your life? Do you see presence of the Holy Spirit? Is he changing your desires? Is he leading you to the interests of Jesus? That's how you know I belong to God. Now the next part says, we are the ones who boast in Jesus. We are the ones who boast in Jesus. What does it mean to boast in something? Well, it means to find significance, to find confidence in that thing, to be proud, to be connected. What happens if your football team wins the national championship? You're gonna hear, the people around you are going to hear about it the next day, aren't they? You're going to boast in that. You're going to find confidence in that. Paul says we're supposed to boast in Jesus. Do we have any reasons to boast in Jesus? Okay, so you're nodding, so now I'm going to ask you. What are the reasons you have to boast in Jesus? Share with me. What are the reasons you have to boast in Jesus? What's so great about Jesus? His love will never end. He answers our prayers. We have hope. Unending hope in Jesus. He's given us salvation. He gives us his mercy. We have freedom in Christ. That's right. We have lots of reasons to boast in Jesus. Are you boasting in Jesus, like this verse says? Is that the big deal in your life? Now, this idea of boasting in Jesus is closely connected with the last line of verse 3. The last line of verse 3 says, do not put confidence in the flesh. And so it's putting these two things in opposition. Confidence in the flesh or boasting in yourself and boasting in Jesus, you can't do both. You got to choose one or the other. Who are you going to boast in? You're going to boast in yourself or are you going to boast in Jesus? We all have a desire to prove ourselves to others, to show other people our value. And here's why. Because all of us feel there's a deficiency inside of us. All of us know that there are areas where we don't measure up. And so we want to compensate. We want to show our value. And the Bible says this comes from the fact that while we were created in God's image, we rebelled against him. When the first humans sinned, something foundational changed in us. Adam and Eve, after they sinned, Genesis 3 says they realized that they were naked and they hid. And do you remember what they went and did? They went and they got a bunch of fig leaves and started sewing them together to try to cover up their insufficiency. Much of human activity, apart from Jesus, is essentially we're just all trying to make clothes out of fig leaves to cover ourselves. We don't want others to see what we are really like, so we try to hide it. And I think there's a couple of places you can see it. A dating relationship, you can definitely see it. So if you're going to go on a date with someone that you're interested in, you're going to get yourself ready, right? And the point of getting yourself ready is that you're trying to highlight the best parts of you and sort of cover up the parts of you that aren't the best. And you do this both physically with your appearance, but you're also doing it figuratively, right? You're not going to let all the crazy out on that first date, right? You're going to hide it. You're going to keep the other person from knowing about it. Or what about in the working world? Think about when you meet somebody new at work. What do you want them to know about you? Well, you want them to know about your accomplishments. You want them to know that you're competent. You want them to know about your connections. You want them to see your value. Or if you ever observe conversations among preschool moms, as they talk about their kids, underneath the smiles and the stories of how well their child is doing, they're all just saying, look at my value. Look at my value. We are all just making fig leaf clothes for ourselves to cover up our insufficiencies. And what we're doing is we're placing our confidence in something other than God. We're placing our confidence somewhere other than God. Look at verses 4 through 6. Paul gives an example of places he used to put his confidence. Paul says, although I have reasons for confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he has ground for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised the eighth day of the nation of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, regarding the law, a Pharisee, regarding zeal, persecuting the church, regarding the righteousness and the law, blameless. Paul says, I have a superior bloodline. I have a superior moral record. If it was a one-up game, Paul would win. But he's going to go on. We'll see this next week. He's going to go on to say that even the greatest human heritage, even the greatest human achievements, all fall short of God's glory. They all fall short. And we are doing this all the time. We're boasting in ourselves and putting our confidence in somewhere other than Jesus. There are things you count on to give you a sense of personal credibility. Now, we talked about this in our study last Sunday night. And I want to read to you a list of areas where a lot of us put our confidence. We put our confidence somewhere other than Jesus. We're looking for value. So listen and see which one of these resonates with you. It describes them as different types of righteousness. You feel good about yourself because of these things. So which one describes you? There's 11 of them. Job righteousness. I'm a hard worker, so God will reward me. Family righteousness. Because I do things right as a parent, I'm more godly than the parents who don't do things the way I do. Theological righteousness. I have good theology. God prefers me over those who have bad theology. Intellectual righteousness. I'm better read, more articulate, and more culturally savvy than others, which obviously makes me superior. Schedule righteousness. I'm a self-disciplined person. I'm rigorous in my time management, which makes me more responsible than other people. Flexibility righteousness. In a world that's busy, I'm flexible and relaxed. I always make time for others. Shame on those who don't. Mercy righteousness. I care about the poor and disadvantaged in the ways that other people should. Moral righteousness. I don't drink, smoke, or chew, or date girls who do. Too many Christians just aren't concerned about holiness these days. Financial righteousness. I manage my money wisely and stay out of debt. I'm not like those materialistic Christians who can't control their spending. Two more. Political righteousness. If you really love God, you'll vote for my candidate. Tolerance righteousness. I am open-minded and charitable toward those who disagree with me. In fact, I'm a lot like Jesus in that way. Any of those hit home with you? Multiple ones? Here's the truth, church family. If you look to anything other than Jesus to make you acceptable, you are believing a false gospel. Anytime you do that, if you look to something other than Jesus to make you acceptable, you are believing a false gospel. You're just making clothes out of fig leaves. Because the true gospel is that you are presentable to God, not by your efforts, but by Jesus' effort. You are presentable because of Jesus and what he's done for you. God is gracious. You don't have to prove yourself. God is gracious. You don't have to prove yourself. Jesus is the only one who can make you right with God. He's the only one who can free you and get you off of that treadmill of trying to cover up, that treadmill of trying to impress others. And how does he free us? By remembering who we are in Christ. That's the path to freedom for us. Remember who you are. Because you're not here to boast in yourself. You're here to boast in Jesus. And when we remember who we are, we will find joy in the Lord. We will find joy. We can rejoice in the Lord. So this morning, church family, I ask you, where does your confidence lie? What is the thing that makes you acceptable? Don't put confidence in yourself. You belong to God. You're the ones that worship by the Spirit. You're the ones that boast in Jesus, and don't put confidence in yourselves. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the good gift of your word this morning. And I pray that we would not find our confidence anywhere other than Jesus. That's a danger for me and for all of my friends in this room. So, Father, I ask that you would use your word to reveal to us where the other places that we're looking for our righteousness, we would repent of those things, and instead we would choose to pursue Jesus, to know him better, to rejoice in Jesus. And I ask this in your name. Amen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name. Great, your love.
nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
What a powerful name it is,
the name of Jesus.
Oh, Let us pray. Holy, holy, holy. Father, we thank you for your presence here this hour. And Father, as we partake this offering, we just pray that you bless this gift as well as the giver. We pray that you bless the decisions of how to use this money to further your kingdom. And Father, we pray as we go out and as we search to who we are, that we find out that you are what truly matters in our life. And that you are the center of our life. And that you become truly holy. And as we do that, then the light will so shine through this church and in our community that we will make a difference in our world today. In your precious name I pray. Amen.
Weary, come all ye thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all ye sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. Oh God, so
failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world. God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. Oh, God so loved, God so loved the world.
Yeah, sometimes get annoyed when we're up here and you sing a song that just really gets stuck in your head and you love the song, but it's going to be stuck in your head for the next week or so. That's how it is with me. And eventually, Janae gets on to me and says, stop singing the song. So, I'm probably going to get in trouble for this next week. But some no-grow-bless opportunities. I almost tried to say opera-bless. That doesn't make any sense. No, but some no-grow-bless opportunities for you guys is, like every Sunday night, we're having Sunday night activities. So in here at 6, we'll be having the Gospel-Centered Life series that Clint's been going over, and both Clint and Carrie say that this was an amazing series, and if you're trusting Clint's judgment up here, I would trust his judgment on that as well, because he typically has pretty sound judgment, but Carrie can probably say there's some times that he doesn't, but we won't talk about those times. But for kids, we have the Grove downstairs, and that's going to be a fun time. That's also at 6, and if you're really interested, you can ask your kid what they're learning. Tell you, you can come tell me, and they might get a prize. And kids, you should ask your parents what they're learning up here, and if they can't tell you, then that just means you're doing better than them. So this week, the youth are going to be going on a mission trip, leaving Wednesday at 10, and we're trying to be coming back around 5 or 6 on Friday. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be going to Tulsa. We're going to be working with a mobile homes mission. The mobile missions works, and they're working within a mobile home park, and we're going to be joining them as they do a Bible day camp, and we're going to be helping them serve and do a lot of things. And then we're also going to be working with Get Out of the Bus Ministries, and they work with homeless and low-income areas of Tulsa, and we'll be traveling around Tulsa in a bus, meeting people and trying to meet both their spiritual and physical needs. So we're going to be leaving this Wednesday at 10, and we're going to be returning Friday at 5 to 6, and we would just ask that you'd be in prayer and that God will work through the youth that are going on that trip, and just pray for safe travels. Also, we want to let you know that there are Easter eggs in the bins. You'll see some bins around the church. There are empty Easter eggs, and we would ask that you would fill them and return them by March 31st. There's an empty bin, which they may have already had all the eggs taken, but if there's eggs in there, we'd ask that you take them and fill them and return them to the bin that's marked filled Easter eggs. Maxine worked hard on that filled, so don't let her be disappointed. March 21st, so next Sunday, we have the Sunday School Teacher Appreciation Luncheon right after service. So if you're a Sunday school teacher, we would like to appreciate you and let you know, hey, we have food for you, because that's the best way to show your appreciation is filling someone's stomach. So please come for that. And then our Easter egg hunt for Easter is going to be April 3rd at Means Park at 12. And that's just going to be a fun time, because we haven't had to have a Easter egg hunt since COVID. The last one was the scavenger Easter egg hunt, which was pretty fun, but people made fun of me. Name of Clint, but we won't talk about that. No, but church family, as we dismiss, I would just like to close this in a word of prayer. So please bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this time, and we ask that throughout this week and throughout the rest of our walk with you that we would boast in you, because none of our other achievements that we could accomplish on our own could ever come close to what you are accomplishing in us and what you have already accomplished. Because God, your Holy Spirit resides in us, and that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is alive in us. And God, we can't boast in any of our achievements, but we can boast in your power and the resurrection that we have in you, because that is the greatest thing that could ever happen on this earth. So God, let us boast in you throughout this week. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You are dismissed.
Oh God, so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power